Transistors are just electrically controlled switches. If we apply high voltage, logic 1, it works like a regular wire. If we apply low voltage, it becomes an open circuit. That one with a small bubble next to it is just the opposite one. Its behavior is inverted. Now we put two of them together. If we carefully look at it, we see that this circuit inverts the input signal. In other words, it works like a NOT Boolean function. Using only those two transistor types, we can build any Boolean function we want. And this is notation for such logic gates. This way, we can build the arithmetics unit. Using these wires, we can pick the operation to execute. This way, we're building a foundation for instruction decoding. Okay, so now we can build a lot of stuff. But the output of all those circuits depends only on current input values. If we want to build a processor, we need to be able to keep some internal state. This circuitry preserves its state. Using set, we can force its output to 1. Look, set signal is disappeared, but the output is still there, until we trigger the reset. This element is called SR latch. Very soon we will use a periodic clock signal to synchronize all the elements. So a few more modifications and our SR latch can work with a clock signal. When the clock is low, both AND gates are locked, so the latch preserves its state. When the clock is high, depending on the D signal, either set or reset is triggered. So the data flows from D to the output only when the clock is high. That kind of latch, transparent only when the clock is high, is called D-latch. Now we put two of them together. When the clock is high, the left one is opaque. When the clock is low, the right one is opaque. But look, when the clock is rising from 0 to 1, the right latch becomes transparent, and at the same time, the inverter introduces a tiny bit of delay. And for a moment, we have both latches transparent. Unlike the D latch, which is transparent only when the clock is high, that one is transparent only on the rising edge. So, this one is called D flip-flop. If we put 32 of them together, we get a register. The one we see in all the machine instructions. We need one more part, memory. So, we want to get data from some address. The corresponding word line is forced to high level. Let's look at the single bit. When the word line becomes high, the transistor opens. The actual bit is stored as a charge of this capacitor. If the capacitor keeps 1, it forces the corresponding bit line to high level. If the capacitor stores 0, the bit line is forced to 0. This way, we can read all the bits for the particular address. Let's build all the stuff together. Here we have a program counter register, memory containing instructions, general purpose registers, and the arithmetics unit. Program counter points to the current instruction. And let's immediately increment it by 4 for the next CPU cycle. So, we are reading the current instruction. The instruction is basically a set of 32 bits. It encodes the operation to perform, and register numbers, where to get arguments, and where to put the result. Now we pass the register numbers of the first and the second argument to the register file. And we pass the operation code to the ALU. Register file is connected to ALU. ALU does the math and sends the result back to write it to the destination register. The only thing we forgot is to inform the register file about the number of the destination register. Done. We managed to build something that looks like a processor. Let's take one step back. Now we can define all the instructions supported, and for each instruction we can define the meaning of each bit. we can also define how does our CPU enters a privileged mode. We can define how it translates virtual memory. All of the above and many more form the instruction set. The most well-known instruction sets are ARM, x86, RISC-V, and many more. If we want to have a brand new custom instruction set, we can design every aspect of it and bake a chip. But if we go for such a unique instruction set, there will not be any software in the world ready to run on it. We will need to implement a compiler, operating system, and all the other software from scratch. We have to port or recompile all the libraries for it, and so on. Dramatic amount of work. If we are more pragmatic, we can design a CPU circuit implementing RISC-V instruction set. Or we can pay some license money and implement ARM instruction set. In both cases, we will have a lot of software ready to go in open source. Again, all the privilege mode logic, virtual memory translation logic, and whatever else mentioned in the instruction set should be implemented in our CPU circuit. But as soon as everything mandatory is implemented, we can start to optimize our CPU implementation. All of our optimizations should be still 100% compatible with the instruction set. And therefore, all the optimizations should be invisible for any software running on the CPU. We can do a lot. CPU caches, branch prediction, out-of-order execution, hyper-threading, memory prefetching. And again, all these optimizations should be completely invisible for any software. All these tricks are usually not part of the instruction set, but they are very important to make a high-end chip. Nowadays people don't connect transistors or logic elements one by one. Circuits are designed using a special language. Despite the fact that it does look like a programming language, it is not. The result of compilation, or to be correct, synthesis, is not a program, but the actual CPU circuit. So with such a hardware description language, people can describe how all the wires and elements are connected. So we have done a complete HDL description of our CPU circuit. Now we need to go to the factory. The factory supplies us with a very detailed description of all the electrical, spatial, and timing properties of the real silicon components. We need to make a layout of our CPU circuit in silicon, make sure that everything works, and ask the factory to make a chip.